Boomhall was the most beautiful place in the world here. We had the happiest times out. My father always loved the horses, and the 8 of us was reared here. Mammy's health was never too good, and we were just practically reared down here. And my own son was reared here, and Martin's boys and the other grandchildren, they all come down, you know. But it's sad to see it go the way it went. It'd be nice to see it back right, you know what I mean, but done correctly, not an old silly way of doing it. A lot of foreigners come here. Chinese, Americans, Polish, all that, they all come down here now. I would love to see the house restored nice again and used properly. Stable yard put back the way it was. Let the young ones see what the past was like.
First time I seen Boomhall, I was just a young child, 6 years of age. My father worked here, like, you know, at some late 40s, and it finished in 1952, I think, to be honest. I worked for the Wrens. The Wrens were stationed here at the time, the Second World War. He was a gardener here. Himself and a man called Willie John Potter did the gardens, plus the fact he looked after the boiler of the house itself. The place itself, out the front there, you could have looked out them windows and you'd have seen the foil there. Brilliant. But I know of it, the house was sold to McDuffitt's, and they came in and lived in on it, you know. And there were people that lived beside us, was Kerry's. And they're a big family, us, like. And the woman Kerry used to take us down here on a Sunday for picnics. And we had our bread stuff with us there, like, to make tea and sandwiches. And we'd have got the water out of King James's well to make a tea.
Where was that?
That's at the back of the Broomhall here on above the shore there, just so it is. I think it's an awful disgrace, you know, that it went so long with that there, like, and nothing been done about it. A house like that there, like, it's a mortal sin, to be honest.
Well, I first became accustomed with Boomhall when I was still at school. I heard from my cousin of mine that there was a job down there for summer holidays of picking gooseberries. The house at that time, it was a house and was still in good condition, although the grounds and everywhere around it was fairly dilapidated. The walled garden was basically overgrown, but there remained in the walled garden fruit trees, pear trees, there was gooseberries, obviously that's why I was there, and there was rhubarb, plus they had a big greenhouse which contained the most loveliest black grapes you could ever taste. We picked gooseberries in baskets which contained about a stone. That's £14, an old money, as they say. But I got 1 shilling for that, for a stone of gooseberries. They were delivered apparently up to fruit shops up on Bishop Street, and from there they were sold. The house itself was a fairly big entrance hall into it. What I remember was there was large paving stones in the main hall. Downstairs, the Wrens had actually had taken over the house during the war years, and the downstairs was, it seemed to have been fixed up. There was beds and things like that, bedrooms downstairs, which maybe were made up for the Wrens when they were there.
It's the most beautiful place. The people don't realise what they have. You know, they just, at their own doorstep, it is, you know, it's just it's me being silly, just, it's home to us boys. And it's just like paradise. You know, once you come down there, you've peace, and you've all the animals around you, the birds and all singing in the morning. It's beautiful. And that when the spring comes, the mare's full and the cow's calving, you couldn't beat it. You know, that's the way I see it. The yard was one of the best yards in this part of the country. This was one of the best yards. The stables in there was unbelievable. And my father cut the hay with the scythe. And he cut every bit of hay, and we carried it in the duck and cart, and we packed the lofts with the hay for the winter time. Yep, and we grew in the garden. My father and two brothers dug it with spades, and then a man drilled it up for us, and we put the spuds in the cabbage and the seaweed, and we grew all the stuff for that there, and it fed the animals, and we took it for the house too, the stuff as well. 2.2 acres of walled garden there, and we dug it all with spades, and we were glad to see the finish is getting dug, I'll tell you. And then the next job was putting all the seaweed in. We brought up the foil with Unkie and Kirt, and we filled the drills, and we put the carrots in, the cabbage, the turnips, and the whole lot. Sweet cabbage that grew in there was a stone weight, or the seaweed. And we fed on the seaweed too, you know. But it'd be lovely to see it all back. It'd be nice for all the community, from, you know, Waterside, Derry, Craig, and Irish State a lot. It'd be beautiful to come and say, you know, this is the past, and this is the way it should be. Because you need things like that, I think.
We're interested in the Williamite Wars. We're interested in the Jacobite defences here at Boomhall. We know that they were here from a map that was done in 1694 by a guy called Neville. And it shows a whole series of fortifications. So what we're trying to do here is find the fortifications that were marked on Neville's map. We've been here, this is our third time. First time we were here was in 2013. We did very small scale excavation at that time. We picked up some artifacts from the 17th century, but we didn't get anything structural. We came back again then last year, and we did work at that time, it was the Siege Museum. We excavated another couple of areas, and we didn't really get anything conclusive there either. So third time lucky, what we're hoping to do is to find these entrenchments for the Jacobite positions during the war. What you have is a wealth of information about the Williamites inside the city and behind the walls being besieged, but we don't really know that much about the Jacobite forces and what was life like for the Jacobites who were undertaking the siege on the outside of the city. And I mean, life could be very grim for soldiers participating in a siege. This will be the third geophysical survey that we've conducted at Boomhall. So we're picking off another area of the landscape that we want to now investigate. We will be here for 3 days doing the geophysical survey, and then we will follow that up with test trenching of the anomalies that are found. And hopefully some of those anomalies will be strong enough for us to be able to get features associated with the war.
Geophysics is a type of survey technique that we use in archaeology, where we look underneath the soil. So it's non-invasive, we don't disturb the soil. You use different types of techniques. So the technique we used here at Boomhall was magnetic. So we have passive sensors. We walk up and down the field with them, and it measures very small changes in the soil's magnetism. So the soil's magnetism can be changed because you light a fire, or maybe because you've dug a ditch and the ditch is like slowly silted up, and that'll change, the microbes will change the magnetism in the soil. So we're going to do geophysical survey in two new areas. So we're hoping that might be able to pinpoint some activity. But it's not luck, it's educated guesses. Yeah. And I mean, the big thing with archaeology is the Donald Rumsfeld, the unknown unknowns. You know, so we occasionally we go in and our educated guess is not in exactly the right place. This time we think we've refined it.
What you're doing is you're looking at how do we understand what happened here in the late 17th century. This is not just a wee war that's fought in Ireland. This is a European war. You have forces from France, you have forces from Holland, you have the English. This is really what's going to happen to the crown of England at this time. And that's why the war is so important, because you have the Williamites and you have the Jacobites. Who's going to win this conflict? If Derry falls, that will mean that they've got a really strong base. The Jacobites will have a really strong base from which to push on and win the war. If Derry stands, then that weakens the Jacobite position, because then it means that you've got the ability of the Williamites to keep building up and building up their forces in the north of Ireland, and to use that then to move and conquer the rest of the island.
Temple Archaeology have been involved with a lot of projects around the area, and Boomhall was one of them. not only on the construction of the ground, on the digging, but the actual building itself, what was going to be done with the building, the heritage of the building, being able to teach kids about what we found. Our aim and objective now is basically to see who's going to look after the building. Well, it's going to be reinsured, well, it's going to be up and running for future generations. And what we're actually doing now is down with archaeologists in Belfast, local people from different organisations are down looking at the ground. But archaeologists in Belfast, Queen's University, will be doing a survey on the ground, and they will be needing the help of local children from the area, and ourselves with temporary archaeology will be down giving them a hand as well.
We love inviting local primary and local secondary schools down to give us a job. Now, you know, we joke that we're getting a bit of free labour, but it's what we're trying to do is trying to imprint like a love of heritage and a love of culture and heritage and where they actually came from. Try and get the kids to start asking questions where they came from, you know, especially in Northern Ireland. It's trying to impress upon people that nobody owns heritage. No one owns our past. You know, it belongs to everybody. You know, not one side can claim it. And, you know, it's great when we can actually get them down, get them digging, get them dirty, get them finding things as well. You know, it's fantastic. And the kids love it too, because they're out from the classroom.
Saul, empty your buckets for me onto this boy heap.
So this is Wednesday, so this is day 3 of that trench. So we've been working our way through the upper deposits, the upper layers in the trench. So we've taken off the grass and taken off the topsoil, and we're actually getting down onto what we think is archaeological features now. The reason we put that trench there was in the geophysical plot, showed up two linear straight features going across there, and there was a chance that these might actually be the trenches relating to the siege in 1689. So that's the main reason why we were putting the trench there. We found a couple of artifacts already just from the very top of these features, but they don't relate to the siege. They're an awful lot older than 1689. So these are four of our prehistoric artifacts that we've actually found in the trench here behind us. We've got three small sherds of very coarse pottery. This pottery is it's they call it coarseware. It's relatively undiagnostic. It's not very easy to date little sherds like that. But given the association with this lovely flint blade, it probably is a Neolithic in date, around about 3000 BC, thereabouts. The fact that we find artifacts like that here isn't surprising, because we're very close to the river, and we're in an area that we know is very rich in prehistoric archaeology. You know, Thornhill, massive Neolithic settlements just up the road, you know, so it's not surprising that there'd be outlying settlements along the river itself.
Well, we started off doing a geophysical survey in the field between Boomhall and the river, and it was magnetic radiometry. So this is a printout of the results of that. So it picks up magnetic readings in the soil. So things like buried pieces of metal give off a reading, also burnt material gives off a reading, but also infilled ditches, because of the bacterial action in the wet soil, they also give off a reading. So our geophysicist highlighted a number of anomalies on the results that she thought would be of interest.
Now, you've just used the word anomaly. What does that mean?
It just means the variations in the magnetism that come up as a reading on the printout. And she's able to highlight ones that she thinks could be archaeological features. So she highlighted this as being a buried metal object. There's also a feature there, which is some kind of linear infilled cut feature. And also, if you see there, there's two parallel features there. And another little feature there, which she's thinking is it might have been an 18th century path to do with the landscaping around the house. Her eye is kind of trained to see things differently from a normal archaeologist, so she kind of sees patterns and things and highlights things that she thinks are of interest.
This is day 3 of the dig.
Mm-hmm.
Have you found anything so far of interest?
We have a trench over one of the features here, and we have actually found a linear feature running through the trench, and 17th century pottery has come into that trench. In another of the trenches we have found a circular concrete object with a spike of metal running through the middle of it. Now, we haven't got it out yet, and we're not exactly sure what it is yet, but we're working on that one. And the other trench that's opened at the minute, nothing's come out of that as yet. People have been finding musket balls and various objects all along the foil, but we've never actually been able to pinpoint where the boom was attached to the shore at this side. I mean, the house is called Boom Hall, but that just gives, because of the general vicinity, we don't have an exact location, but it would be very important for the history of the city to find the exact location.
Some amateur detectorists have found material in the grounds. What kind of material have you found?
There's coins, there's modern coins, there's slightly older coins, lots of musket balls. We've got two metal detectors with us. They're carrying out a metal detector survey, so they're kind of working in a systematic fashion across the field. And they're highlighting anything they find, they put in a little bag, and we're going to come along afterwards and GPS in the position of everything they find. So we're hoping if they find lots of musket balls, we might find patterns of musket balls that would highlight where there was fighting going on. The man from Ballinagard House has been down. He metal detects on his own ground and he's kept everything he's found, and he has lots of musket balls from his land.
So that's the kind of indication that the metal map is telling some kind of truth.
Yes, yeah.
This is the third dig that Queens have carried out on the Boomhall site, trying to find evidence of the battle and of the boom. And this one has been more successful than the previous two in finding evidence of a battle, because we have found quite a number of musket balls, not as many as we would have expected, but we certainly on the trenches have found a significant number of musket balls. And what is particularly interesting about the two types of musket balls is that a round musket ball, if you find it intact, is a ball dropped by a soldier firing a gun and he's fumbled and he's dropped the ammunition as he's loading his musket. And if you find a piece of flat lead, it means that it's a musket ball that was fired at the person standing at the place you found it. So we can tell from the musket balls that we now have some of the musket balls that were fired by the Williamite forces from the boats, the Mountjoy and the Dartmouth, and the boats that were coming up the Foyle, at the soldiers who were at Boomhall. And that tells us that there were soldiers standing at that very point. So it's very interesting to be able to reconstruct a battle that way. We've also found a lot of musket balls, dropped musket balls, along the shoreline from the site of the boom, along the Crook of Inver, where the nature reserve is now. And that means that soldiers were walking along the shoreline, firing at the boats as they had broken the boom. And of course, that was the famous moment when the Mountjoy broke the boom, when Captain Browning, having run aground, given the command to fire the cannon, was able to bring the ship off the mud bank, save the day. And at that very moment, he and six of his crew were shot by the musket men. And of course, Captain Browning died. His wife was waiting for him at the quay up in Derry. So it's a very important moment in history. It was as important as Nelson dying on his ship at the moment of triumph. And it's a story about a moment in history where there was a turning point, and it was because of one man who died immediately. He gave the order that saved the day. The joy of the defenders of the city seeing the boats coming up, and the joy of Captain Browning's wife seeing her husband sitting up, was destroyed by the fact that when the boat arrived, he was lying dead on the deck. So it's a heroic story, and it's been confirmed to some extent. The narrative of the battle has been confirmed by our finds so far, because the pattern of musket balls would indicate that there was a running battle between the Mountjoy and the Jacobite defenders along the shoreline where musket men were firing at the boat. Queens were trying to find whether the Neville map reflected the reality of what was on the ground, or whether it was a representation of standard fortifications. And the problem is that there's been three or four different maps, all of which are slightly different. And the difficulty was finding the points at which the cannon were fired from. On Neville's map, there are very distinct places where the cannon were supposed to be placed, but we cannot find as yet those places. Now, it may be that those were destroyed in some of the landscaping that occurred in the 18th and 19th century. It may be that on the other side of the river, we can verify that the map was accurate because there were features on the other side of the river. So there's a future piece of work to be done to verify whether it's the map is different or whether there has been a destruction of the evidence because of landscaping. But what is very interesting is that the map shows trenches, and we have discovered a trench, but to our surprise, it appears to be a Neolithic trench. The Neolithic period was from 4000 BC to 2500 BC, so it could be up to 6000 years old. And in that trench, we have found flint, which would indicate early Neolithic inhabitants, where they would have used the flint to skin animals, etc.
So in many senses, that makes the site doubly important.
Well, the site clearly has a Neolithic aspect to it, which was never known before. And it would tally with what has been found in Thornhill, what has been found in Enoch Loch across the river directly from it. And it makes sense that in Neolithic times, rivers were the highways of their day, and people settled around the rivers and used the rivers like we would use a motorway today. And if you were going to find anything Neolithic, the ideal place to find it is going to be on a narrow point of the River Foyle, where people can catch salmon and where they can get their boats easily onto the river to navigate all around the coast. So there appears now to be evidence emerging of a series of Neolithic settlements, which Boomhall would be part of. And there was a previous excavation, not done by Queens, but by an archaeology firm for a private company, and they discovered what they believed to be a roundhouse very near the Foyle Hospice as well. That didn't form part of this investigation, that's another day's work, but certainly there is evidence of Neolithic settlement at this site. And our intention is to keep that site as pristine as possible, because it's unveiling new stories every day. One of which, as a great matter of interest, is we found in the excavations, in one pit, we found a 1920s German round of ammunition. Now that raises an amazing question about whether there were people using German guns for practice down at Boomhall, and that's for another day. But it certainly is a new question that we were not expecting to have to ask ourselves about that Boomhall site. There were many interesting little artifacts found down there, one of which was a lead seal with a fleur-de-lis on it. Now, a lead seal would have been a soldier would have received his orders with a lead seal on it. And because there's a fleur-de-lis on it, it means it's certainly from the French army. And what was interesting about the seal was that it was found near King James's Well. There is a well at Boomhall called King James's Well on the maps for centuries, and it was the place where King James was reputedly garrisoned when he came to visit the Boom. There was also, intriguingly, also previously a piece of French pottery found, 17th century pottery found, very close to where that French seal was found. So there's evidence of soldiery there, there's evidence of high-ranking people there at that point, and all of that, again, is pointing towards the Boom having been very close to where we were looking at. So that's one artifact that gives us a set of intriguing clues. Also found in the orchard was a number of implements that we believe could have been used, and we're only speculating at this stage, could have been used for the actual construction of the Boom. We found a very large metal wedge, which is very similar to ones that have been found along the shoreline in other parts, but in the orchard there was a concentration of metal implements, such as a wedge for splitting wood, which would have been consistent with what was required to build the Boom. So we believe that the pine for the second Boom was brought down to the orchard, which appeared to be the end of the road on the Neville maps, offloaded, split, and the Boom was constructed at that point and then brought down to the river. So again, another story appears to be unfolding. And what's interesting about where we found the wedges is that that was the site of a previous find of an actual musket. Not the musket ball, the actual musket that fired the balls. So all of that indicates that we need to do a little bit more investigation there, because we believe there's a story to be told about the orchard. We believe that a garrison may have been there to have put it out of harm's way of any cannon fire from a boat from the Foyle. So it may be that the soldiers, be evidence of soldiers actually garrisoned up at that point. The Boomhall site, the whole site of Derry, was very strategically important, because King James had fled England when William arrived, and he'd gone to France. He'd returned to Ireland to make a stand in Ireland. He then intended to go across to Scotland if he was able to secure Ireland. Now, to secure the north of Ireland, you have to secure Derry. Derry was built, the walls of Derry were built where they were precisely because any person who wants to hold the north must hold the foil. Because if you have an army anywhere around Mid-Ulster, you could be outflanked by an army sailing in behind you in the foil. So Derry was built for war. The location of Derry itself was all about holding the north of Ireland. And what was strategically important for James was that he had to hold the north of Ireland to, as a stepping stone to Scotland, apart from everything else. And to do that, he had to hold Derry. So when his army was rebuffed from Derry and when they were locked out, this was a very serious situation. This was the first time that James was actually going to stand up against the Williamite army. He had fled England. Ireland was the place he was making his stand, and Derry was the first place it was really going to happen. So what was strategically important is that when he lost Derry, he couldn't hold the north. He then had to flee down through past Enniskillen and down to the Boyne, where there was going to be a stand against William, but it was never going to be won by James because he could never hold a river. He could be outflanked on any river, and he was outflanked. That's why he lost the Battle of the Boyne. And from that, it was all over, because Boomhall was really the end of kings. That's really what it was. After that, you had the Bill of Rights established in the British Constitution, and that brought in a whole modern era of government where kings were not in charge. Parliament was, from that point forward, sovereign. The king was no longer sovereign. The divine right of kings was dead as a doornail after Boomhall. And it boils down to the heroic efforts of a small number of people whose musket balls fired we found at Boomhall.